The Goldenrod Foundation is pleased to present the fourth talk in its series, Making Waves in Coastal Conservation. The series features up-and-coming experts working with new technologies, innovative ideas, and fresh perspectives relevant to southeastern Massachusetts. Our speaker is Catherine Bryars, a master's degree candidate at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Her talk is entitled Peecycling for Our Coasts and Crops, What Urine Reclamation Can Do for You and Your Town.
So as I was getting ready to come out to this presentation in Plymouth, I realized what a treasure it is for me to be able to come and give a presentation in the town where our country was born years ago. So who here is actually from Plymouth? Hey, so what is this image? Do you guys know?
that's Plymouth Rock.
That's Plymouth Rock, yeah. And I have to have my cheat sheet. This is what my cheat sheet's for. The Landing of the Pilgrims. It's a very famous painting by Henry Bacon. So I found this. This is a very iconic pilgrim and Plymouth Rock image. And I was thinking to myself, well, she's a young woman. I'm a young woman. What must she have been thinking as she was the first person to step in onto Plymouth Rock? And I thought, hey, maybe she was thinking she had to go to the bathroom, right? I mean, come on, you've been on this boat for like so long, you're just like, I want to get to the bushes, right? Let me get there as fast as I can. That's really what we're always thinking about, isn't it? Are we there yet? Are we there yet? So then it also got me thinking, so what was the bathroom situation where these people were coming from at the time? So the pilgrims landed at Pilgrim Rock at Plymouth Rock in 1620. So around that time, fairly recently beforehand, one of the people that's credited with inventing the flush toilet, and there's been many people that have invented iterations of the flush toilet throughout time. One person is John Harrington, and he especially got fame for his invention of the flush toilet because he made one for Queen Elizabeth I. This was his design, and you pulled a lever and water washed your pan where you had just gone to the bathroom. Reportedly, Elizabeth I actually didn't like it very much because it made noise and then people knew that she went to the bathroom. Imagine that. And, you know, so from back then, 1620, it wasn't until 255 years later that there was the founding of the company which later became American Standard. So how have we gone from having this first step onto Plymouth Rock years ago, 1620, and then years later, the flush toilet actually is now out in the world and it's kind of the American Standard. Flush toilet is how we go to the bathroom. And if you don't yet go to the bathroom with a flush toilet, you better want to go to the bathroom with a flush toilet. That's really, it's such a symbol for modernity today. But what else was going on? There's obviously, between Plymouth Rock Landing and this 255 years, there's all different kinds of sanitation solutions going on. So what else has been going on? I'm gonna cover that a little bit more throughout my talk, but first I'll just give you an overview. So we're gonna talk about why peecycling, what is peecycling. There are a lot of experts also in the room, but for people that aren't experts, how familiar are you with peecycling? Is this the first time you've heard about it? Yeah? Okay, so we'll talk about what it is. A little bit more historical context, some modern cases. I'm mostly gonna focus on a project that's going on up in Brattleboro, Vermont called the Rich Earth Institute, of which Kim, who's in the room, is one of the directors. So we're very happy to have her here. And just play with some numbers to see what the potential for Plymouth might be. And I enjoy, if you start to Google image toilets, you will come up with all kinds of funny images that really speak about, you know, our toilet system in ways that we don't actually speak about it. And yet, we can see here what you're really flushing down the toilet with every flush. So to talk about what peecycling is, which we also call urine nutrient reclamation, I'll just go word by word. So urine, why urine? First of all, urine is actually sterile. It's because of a phenomenon called urine blindness. We don't tend to think of urine as a separate entity from feces. Lots of people just think of them together, and the same things that are in feces, which include the pathogens like E. coli that can really affect human health, they're in feces. They're actually not in healthy populations found in urine. My advisor advised me, as advisors do, not to talk about urine blindness. He thought I made it up. He was like, are you being a little too bold? Did you make up this term urine blindness? It sounds like somebody got pee in their eye. And I was like, no, it's a thing. Really, scientists talk about urine blindness. And that's what it is. We have this difficulty to see urine as its own entity. But it's actually sterile. It's a liquid, which makes it fairly easy, relatively easy to divert and collect, store, and apply as a fertilizer. And why urine? Because with every flush, you actually are flushing up to 7 gallons of cleaned drinking water. That's very not only expensive, but for any of us that love the environment, and we're all here tonight because we do, who wants to be flushing that much water? Actually, if you haven't, this lowest requirement is 1.28 gallons. That is the lowest amount that you would get based on regulations that were put into place in 1992. So if you are using a toilet in your home that was installed prior to 1992, it's using upwards of 3.5 gallons per flush. And what are we talking about nutrients-wise? So when we're talking about what's in urine, and again, this is just urine, there's 10 pounds, up to 10 pounds of nitrogen, and almost a pound of phosphorus. And this is based on a Western diet. If you go other places in the world, nutrient levels change. But for typical Western diets, these are around the numbers. And an NPK, it actually is an NPK of 11, 1, 2 on average. Again, that changes, but that's a very impressive number. Just to visualize what the difference is. So for nitrogen, we're really talking about most of it being in urine. It's way upwards, consistently upwards of 80%. And the phosphorus as well is upwards of 60% consistently. Here's another visualization. People are totally weirded out by this fact, but you actually produce much more solid matter in your urine than you do in your feces. So if you were to dry out all of your urine and your feces, this is the amount of solid matter that you would have after a year in your urine. And this is the amount of solid matter you have in your feces. Your feces is mostly water. And if you start collecting your urine, which I know also a lot of people in this room, Nakasuhu, do, you actually start to see the solids that accumulate in your urine. And at the same time, this is the amount of water that we're using, clean drinking water, to flush over a year period. And phosphorus is the last big topic. Maybe if we have time, we can talk about it in more detail. But basically, phosphorus is a vital mineral for food growth. It's vital to root stimulation. Without phosphorus, we can't grow our food. And currently, it's mined almost exclusively from Morocco and a couple of other places in the world. And we're running out. A lot of people say that within 50 years, we're going to have depleted those mining sources. So if we don't find ways to recycle the phosphorus that we're producing, and you've already seen the large amounts that we're producing, we're going to be running out of phosphorus soon. And why reclamation? Well, I like saying reclamation because I love reminding people that urine diversion is not a new thing. Peecycling is not a new age, oh my gosh, we finally realized this new solution we never realized before. Urine recycling and waste recycling as a whole of our waste has been part of human societies sustaining their agricultural systems for centuries. And what we're doing is we're really just reclaiming that practice. Historically, this period in time is an anomaly. Always before, human societies have recycled their waste, and we are actually not. And additionally, by making it into an environmental contaminant, we're just really, if we met people from a century ago, they'd be like, what are you? You know, what are you guys doing? The human food nutrient cycle briefly talks about how we have these nutrients that are in the soil. We extract them when we grow our food. We eat them, and those nutrients basically stay the same and leave our bodies as waste. Currently, with waterborne systems, they're sent to wastewater treatment plants if you have a sewer system, or into your septic system, which is then usually also emptied and goes to a sewer system. And 50% of the solids that are produced through that process are recycled as agricultural amendments. I'll tell you more about that. But we're not closing the cycle. Essentially, this is a broken cycle. So that's what we mean by the human food nutrient cycle. Something to explain here is sequester and treat PPCPs. This is a benefit of urine source diversion, source separation. PPCPs stand for pharmaceuticals and personal care products. So what are those? Those are obviously pharmaceuticals that we're consuming. They're also personal care products, soaps, lotions, shampoos. They get absorbed into your body and they become concentrated and leave your body via your urine. So urine represents really a sequestering of these components, which right now are going out into the environment and we're not sure what they're doing there exactly, especially pharmaceuticals. And what do we do when, what happens when we put those on food? We're not sure, but what's happening when we just put them into the toilet, that dispersal is uncontrolled. That goes out into waterways. It goes out onto agricultural fields. If we concentrate them in urine, we can figure out what these are doing, if we can remediate them, and what to do. But a lot of people, if we want to also have a discussion about that later, that's another good point to bring up. And the Rich Earth Institute up in Vermont will be doing experiments on that this summer. Do you guys know what this is a picture of? Come on, go ahead and guess. I want to hear stuff. What are people thinking?
Looks like a satellite picture.
Yep. And what's going on here around the coast?
Oh, I can guess.
Yeah, that's algae. Those are algal blooms, eutrophication. So what's happening here is that nutrients, and they come from all different kinds of sources, fertilizer, runoff, but also the nutrients that are in our human waste that are leaching out of our sewer systems and out of our septic systems enter the water. They are fertilizer. I mean, our waste really is a fertilizer. So, of course, it causes these algal blooms. A result of that is the surface of the water is covered. Light doesn't get in. The plant material absorbs all the oxygen and depletes the water ecosystem, which then becomes stagnant and you can see that process happening here with the septic system. This is actually how septic systems are designed to work. This is a well-working septic system. Eventually, nutrients leach out into the water, and that shouldn't be a problem, but especially around highly populated areas and here in the coastal areas where this groundwater level is actually extremely high. These nutrients in high-density areas go and cause that type of eutrophication that you're seeing. And again, the results of this are dying ecosystems, stagnant ecosystems. You can see the difference here. This is actually down in the Gulf of Mexico, which has one of the largest dead zones. And dead zones are another name for these areas that are spreading across the world. Here's the alive water, and here's the dead water. Yeah. Here's also just a quick look, a glance, at where some of these dead zones, these growing dead zones are. That looks close to home, yeah? And again, these are highly dense living areas and also areas where lots of fertilizers are in use and where lots of people live and are putting their waste directly into waterways, like via a flush toilet, as opposed to having dry sanitation systems where nutrients are dispersed other ways. Again, another way that this happens, we saw that there's septic systems, also with sewer systems. Sewer systems eventually drop water into waterways. But combined sewer overflows is what CSO means. So again, a sewer system, in the same way that a septic system is designed to work well, a sewer system is designed to work well when there's a lot of water. It overflows into bodies of water. And that's a planned part of what happens, and it happens more regularly than a lot of us want to hear about. And maybe that's one reason we don't hear about how often these things are happening. So these are just a couple of the problem areas where there's consistent combined sewer overflows happening. Again, pretty close to home. So I mentioned before that we actually are already recycling these rich nutrients that are in our waste, but we're currently doing it via biosolids. Who's heard of biosolids before? Yeah, great. One brand of biosolid that you can get down the road anywhere is milorganite. And for people who don't know, milorganite is Milwaukee's biosolids. So it's everything that's going into a wastewater treatment plant. It's processed, and the solids that come out on the other end are applied as a fertilizer. So what else is going into our sewer systems that's not just human waste and fertilizer? Everything. Industrial waste. Everything. For example, fragrances. Pesticides, again, these personal care products, detergents, cleaning products, lots of fats, lots of anything that people can just pour down your toilet, anything you guys can go home and pour down your toilet, That's what's ending up in these biosolids. And 50% of biosolids produced in the US are recycled on agricultural land. That's 7 million dry tons of biosolids that are spread on our food. And they grow our food. For example, if you buy a loaf of bread at the store, the chances that that was grown with biosolids are pretty good. So you can just get, this is a recent, actually Kim just sent it to me yesterday, a recent report that just came out this month detailing some of what's in there. So, and I keep this under reclamation because basically this is already happening. These nutrients are being recycled, and yet we're not in direct control of them. Do you know what I mean? It's a very distant process that we have with this. Whereas if communities could take more control of where their urine is going, where these nutrients are going, how we're treating them, where we're putting them, the environmental contamination could be avoided, mitigated, and fertilizer could be produced. There's also challenges. You always have to talk about the challenges as well. This is not a panacea. There are legitimate reasons why these types of solutions, which have been popular in the past, have come and gone. But this is my assessment of why this is challenging right now, adopting Peecycling. The first is path dependence, and that refers to how infrastructures that we invest in as a society put us on a path. And then once you've already put money into a system like a sewer system or a septic system, you have a built-in disincentive to try something else. Even if the other option suddenly is a better idea and you realize that, you're like, well, we just spent $100,000 on building installing a septic system for our neighborhood. So that's what I mean by path dependence. That's commonly the retort, is that, well, we have a sewer system, so what can we do? There's a perception of low user receptivity, and this is a lot of what my research is on right now. I want to clarify that it's a perception of low user receptivity rather than actual low user receptivity. There have been studies all over the world, and depending on the culture, also depending on how this technology is introduced, there's actually very high user receptivity. But there's the obvious reasons why: odor, inconvenience, scalability. Again, the PPCPs are coming up. We don't have a lot of answers yet. They're in process. For example, in Rich Earth, they're going to be studying that this summer, trying to find more answers about what happens to pharmaceuticals if they're applied to the land. They may not be absorbed by plant material. They may actually break down better in plant material than, say, if you put them in a wastewater treatment plant. But how do you actually measure that? So all of these things result in a low political will to actually innovate these systems that we have. And again, I wanted to say that my research focuses on there being a perception of low user receptivity rather than actual low user receptivity. This is a picture of the public using urine-diverting porta-potties that were installed by the Rich Earth Institute at a public event last summer, and the public loves them. They thought it was just fantastic. It was the best porta-potty they'd ever used because it doesn't smell, because it's just not what you would expect. You hear about something relating to a composting toilet, people think of pit latrines, maybe, that their grandfather had to use and was a big black hole. And the fact is that there are very modern options. Again, we have Hilda and Earl here, who have an eco-toilet center where they live. And it shows all of the modern systems that we have that are urine-diverting toilet systems and composting toilet systems. They're very modern. They can be as comfortable or more comfortable than the flush toilet that we're accustomed to. To give a little bit more context, we'll jump back again. So what was happening in the world between 1620, when we landed on Plymouth Rock and were looking for a place to go, and 1875, when the American Standard Company was started to propagate flush toilets for the world? One thing that was happening is the case of Paris, France. So in Europe, there was this huge transition to using nitrogen fertilizers that were imported from Chile in the form of guano, so bird poop. You guys heard of the guano trade before? Mm-hmm. This is the first large-scale, total redirection of nutrient and fertilizer flows that happen in the world. A lot of people think, if you think of that topic, you think of the Green Revolution of the 1950s and 60s. Actually, the first time that agriculture was totally changed around happened way before. It happened with the guano trade. And yet, Paris, France was an exception to the rule. Paris, France had invested a lot of money and time and expertise into actually measuring what the nutrient value of human waste was, both as both in urine and combined feces. You can see here, I'm going to show you, just go through them, how they were measuring it. So you can see there's urine from public urinals. This is what I was referencing for some students that were here before. They actually had public urinals to collect urine to recycle, and they valued it, and then they could see how much money they were saving by sourcing their fertilizer locally as opposed to buying it on a global international market. You can see all the different kinds that there were. The poudrette is a dried composted human waste collected. Also sewage, street sludge, because there were still pail systems where people collected in their house and then just dumped it on the street. But they had really studied and broken down all of it. They then also set up specific sewage farms. And again, check the dates on these. So this is 1910. This is 100 years ago. This is not something that happened 500 years ago that we abandoned for good reason. This is only 100 years ago that the city invested in farmlands that were very close to the center of the city that they fertilized exclusively with these types of collected fertilizers. And the rent on these farms was through the roof, way more expensive to rent these lands than to rent any other farming land in the French countryside, because the soil was so rich and gave such good results. Because they were actually called sewage farms. Imagine if you opened up a farm, your local CSA today, and you called it the sewage farm. Oh my goodness. But back then, you called something a sewage farm, and people loved it. People really got the value. Just to wrap this up, I'll say that, you know, of course, Paris eventually did transition to waterborne systems exclusively and did more simple dumping of their waste as opposed to reclaiming it, recapturing it, and applying it. And really, this is part of the war economy that developed at the turn of the century as technologies to develop synthetic fertilizer or synthetic nitrates were developed actually for ammunition for the war economy. That same technology to produce nitrates is actually what produces synthetic fertilizer. So as the cost for that went down, and you can see how meticulously the Parisians were measuring the value, when simply the cost of producing synthetic fertilizer got low enough, they couldn't continue to justify these otherwise totally justifiable practices. But now we're here today. And again, remember that these things going on again, 1901, 1910 was the last one, not as long ago as we might think. So what we're doing today is we're reclaiming some of these technologies and these practices. The first group I'm going to talk about, and really the group I'm going to talk about in most detail, is the Rich Earth Institute up in Vermont, founded in 2012 with the mission to advance and promote the use of human waste as a resource. And it does have the claim of being the first community-led field trial in the application of human urine as a fertilizer in the USA. While this has been done in small levels in other areas of the world, particularly in Europe, this has not been done in the US, and we're kind of wondering why. Why have people not gotten onto this bandwagon yet? This is another representation of that food nutrient cycle I hinted at before. It can really visualize the returning of nutrients back to their source. In the first year, 600 gallons of urine were collected from 70 volunteer community participants. That alone is impressive, getting 70 people to voluntarily figure out how in their house they're going to hoard urine. I keep calling it hoarding urine, and the other people in the organization are like, stop saying hoarding. Hoarding is bad. And it is bad. It's not the correct collecting urine. But I love saying hoarding urine because people get really upset about it. So that was happening in 2012. In 2013, we actually jumped up to 3,000 gallons and more than doubled our participant size. And now we're about, you know, at 170 participants. The full scale of the project currently is across 3 states and 5 counties. I think that is incredibly impressive. But of course, it's mostly centered around Brattleboro, the home of the project. We have, now we have 4 farms participating, or 3. 4 farms that are accepting urine. They're not members of the organization. These are just farms. They're family farms that want the urine to be applied to their fields, mostly as a hay fertilizer, so it becomes feedstock for animals. And then we have other urine depots that have been opened to facilitate the dropping off of urine to make the volunteer urine donors' participation easier. So So I'll go through these. I've identified these six things that are really key to how rich earth does what it does, and the questions that people have about how the heck are you able to do this. So the first is collection. How are you guys doing this? How are you getting all these over 170 people to actually collect urine in their home? And let me tell you, there are a lot of creative people out there that come up with a lot of different ways. We're sure we haven't even heard every little detailed story yet. But a popular one is having a QB that has a funnel. As you can see here, there's a little ping pong ball. So if you collect your urine in your hand, however you're gonna do that, you then pour it into the funnel and the ping pong ball floats up. And then when it sinks down, it covers up the top and you don't smell it. That's how we eliminate odor. There's also these porta potties, which have been upgraded for this year to be used at public areas where we can collect urine from the public at large. And that urine, since it's a good sample of the public, is what's going to be used for testing this summer, because we're going to be seeing what happens to pharmaceuticals when you apply them to the soil. This is my own little toilet that I was using at home this past year. People come up with all different kinds of ways of doing it. Storage is the next question. How do you store all this urine? And this is a big challenge with urine collection and application, is that you actually produce a lot more urine than you would ever realize until you start collecting it. This would get filled up at my house with two people. It was filled within a month. And this is a 5 gallon QB, easily. And that's both of us working actually out of the house. We peed a lot. But this is more or less how people would, you know, people had their variations, but for the most part, 5 gallon QBs, which would then get dropped off at a urine depot. This is one that's at the home of the Rich Earth Institute. And these are 55 gallon drums. And then the largest containers are 275 gallon tanks. And I want to focus on this for a second, because where this is at the Brattleboro wastewater treatment plant.
Wow.
Right? Can we get a collective like, wow,
yeah,
nice. Hey, imagine that. So one thing that Rich Earth has done amazingly well is they've formed community partnerships. And without these community partnerships, this project would not be happening. Key partnerships, like with the wastewater treatment plant, that would otherwise potentially feel very threatened by a project like this. Oh, well, you divert all of the urine. How are we going to sell our biosolids when they no longer have nutrient value? Well, you reduce the flow of water into the system. How is that going to reduce our workload? How could that reduce, you know, are we really talking about a paradigm shift in sanitation? Well, then you're shifting away from a wastewater treatment plant. Those are some potential, you know, and naysayer, well, it's not going to work. What are all those people going to do for jobs? This is where the heart of why the project has been so successful is for me, for my interpretation, for my studies, because these partnerships do exist. And the people working at the wastewater treatment plant believe in this technology, believe that it's a good thing for the environment, for the economy, for the local community. And so they stored, how much urine?
1,000 gallons
of urine over the winter so that it wouldn't freeze in one of their buildings. Transport. So here is the next big community partnership that I would like to focus on. This is a local company, Best Septic, and this is Seth. Seth pumps out septic tanks. And what he's done is he does a special cleaning of his tank on his car, totally cleans it out, sanitizes it, to then be able to pump out the urine and take it to the participating farms that are waiting for it. This type of a partnership may be unseen, maybe not even rational. Wait, why would a septic hauler have the incentive to invest in a technology that might make his job irrelevant? The idea is that it doesn't make his job irrelevant. It actually gives him a new kind of job, and it's a more sustainable job, and it's one that's investing in the community and in the local farms, getting fertilizer to a local farm that otherwise can't afford it. That's something that has been said by farmers that are participating, is that if they don't get this fertilizer, they can't afford fertilizer. And this has really been key for them. So what Seth is going to be doing for this season, for 2014, he's actually putting on a whole separate tank onto his truck that he's always driving around the community, which he will always be stopping at these urine depots to pump out urine and kind of be constantly transporting it.
treatment, there's two methods. One is a time storage, which if you put the urine into a greenhouse and it gets above a certain temperature, the temperature and ammonia production together eradicate all pathogens. And then there's also a pasteurization process, which we also call the pisteurization process. So we have, I mean, could it get any more Vermont? We have a solar-powered pisteurizer, right? Right? But it works, and through these two methods, for the last 2 years, we've sanitized all the urine before application as a fertilizer. Then there's application. So another thing to be aware of with pee recycling is that pee is powerful stuff. If you haven't gotten it by now, really, this is where you'll get it. To be applied as a fertilizer, you have to dilute it. If you put urine directly onto the ground, it actually burns and can kill a plant. It then may actually come back even more vibrant after it kind of dies down for a second, but at first it becomes burned because the ammonia content, the nitrogen content, is so high. So these are two application methods that have been used up there. One is for small plots, and the other is for large tracts. And the difference here is because there's been a lot of testing, soil and plant material testing going on. What's being tested is, so far, different dilution rates to see what processes grow the most, are the most effective as fertilizers. What's been happening at the rich earth, all of this process of not only collecting, transporting, treating all of the urine, there's also been very rigorous testing. And so far it's happened in conjunction with the USDA, with the EPA. Now it's happening with WRF, who's a National Water Research Foundation. And there's soil testing and there's plant material testing to see what the enhanced nutrient content is in plant materials and what happens to pathogens and microbial life also in the soil when you use pee as a fertilizer. As I said, my work, and again, I'm in regional planning, and what do regional planners really do anyway? I don't know, I haven't figured it out yet. But one thing that I know that we do is we figure out how do you make relevant technologies actually usable for communities, especially for sustainability. So what I've been identifying is how the community partnerships that Rich Earth has built upon have really been key to making this a possible project. And really, if you step back for a second, if somebody just told you this were going on, few people would believe it. Really, most people are incredulous that over 170 people are voluntarily collecting, hoarding urine in their houses and then making it into a fertilizer to grow, you know, food. And yet it is happening. And this is how it's happening with septic haulers, with wastewater treatment plant. Also, planners and regulators have been very supportive of the project. They love this project. They really believe in it and have been trying their best to make everything work the whole way along. And again, these voluntary urine donors. Now, I've been collecting urine myself. And if you don't have a composting toilet or a urine diverting toilet, which, you know, makes the process just the same as going and using a normal toilet, only you're not wasting all the drinking water. If you're trying to figure out another method, it can be a little bit more cumbersome, which a lot of people are fine with. And also, it's another thing to add to your list to do. And yet, people are doing it. Even for people that have not yet been able to invest in larger systems that make it a breeze or as easy as a flush toilet, people are still doing this. I've mostly just focused on what's been happening up in Vermont. There's more projects that I'm in the process of researching for my master's project. And one of them is the Florence Organic Garden in Florence, Massachusetts. This is Adele, and she's really been the powerhouse behind getting a urine diverting composting toilet in at her local community garden. This has been actually built by Ben over here. We're now trying to figure out what to do with the diverted urine. For the last year, it's gone up and supported the project in Brattleboro. And now we want to figure out, hey, we want to do this here. Why can't we do this in Massachusetts, right? And regulation can be a challenge. So I'm working side by side with Adele to make an application to the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection to see how we can approve a process to produce a solid compost. Bless you. A solid compost out of urine, which then can be used, rather than having the liquid fertilizer that they're using up in Brattleboro, how can we actually create a solid? We're in the middle of that process. We're seeing how it's going. So far, the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection has been incredibly supportive and understanding. They're trying to figure out how to handle this, and they don't. There's no regulatory framework for working with urine. They go, well, you mean like biosolids, right? Nope, we don't mean biosolids. Well, you mean like leachate? Like leachate is this liquid that comes off of a composting toilet that's kind of like a soup. It's really nasty stuff. Well, actually, we're finding out it's not so nasty. There you go. But, you know, people go, that sounds nasty. And it's not, to begin with. And source-separated urine is even less potentially nasty, you know, especially for smells, potentially. And but the basic line is people don't know how to handle this, and we're trying to pioneer that. But if we can get this project approved in Massachusetts, that opens the door for a lot of other projects to follow, same ones and similar ones. There's been a couple of different initiatives on Cape that are really looking at composting toilets and urine diversion. The Cape Cod Eco Toilet Center I've mentioned already. It's a center that shows all the most up-to-date technologies and systems that are available. And Falmouth, as a town, has invested in an eco-toilet program where they're giving families up to $5,000 to invest in a system to test the viability and the user receptivity of these programs to see if they, for example, are a viable alternative to a sewer system or enhanced septic systems. So there is interest and curiosity on the part of regulators. So it's how do you best work with that? There's also a man, George Hoyfelder, who's the director of the Barnstable Public Health Department. He runs the Massachusetts Alternative Septic System Test Center. So they're always, you know, it's a test center. They're playing with stuff all the time. One thing that they're working on right now is putting irrigation lines beneath the soil. And actually, a lot of the urine that's being collected via toilets that are participating in the Falmouth Eco Toilet Program, they're receiving the urine there, and they're trying to figure out what do we do with this that's safe, because this is again the public health department that's really helping to support this. How do we dispose of this unforeseen, up until now, you know, unforeseen potential entity? How do we deal with it in a safe way? And so they're using it to irrigate crops, subsoil, and it's basically drip irrigation with diluted urine straight to soils. So again, these are projects that I don't know as much about right in this moment. I'm going to be looking at them over the next year. But there's a lot of stuff going on right in this neighborhood, you know, and maybe we don't hear about it all the time, but things are really picking up. You know, this is really catching on. So just a quick look at Plymouth. You know, nudge, nudge. Here we are. You know, we come full circle, right? We started at Plymouth Rock, and now we're back in Plymouth again. So Plymouth Town residents, again, it's 56,574. That is equivalent to 565,740 pounds of nitrogen produced every year. Every year. That's a lot of nitrogen. And 45,259 pounds of phosphorus. That's a lot of phosphorus. That can grow a lot of food. And just driving around here, I've seen there's a lot of beautiful countryside, and there's also farms all around the area that could potentially want a cheap to free fertilizer source if we could start figuring out ways to collect these resources, and especially in the interest of our coastal water systems, to not continue to let them become environmental contaminants, which is what they become today with the systems that are predominant. So just to recap, we covered Peecycling's potential and challenges, a little bit of the historical context. We could go much deeper, much further, and have endless conversations about how these technologies have been used throughout time, but I just wanted to give you a taste. Some modern cases of Peecycling, and just throwing out the idea of what might happen in a town like Plymouth. So again, if anybody has questions about these or any other part of the presentation, we can talk about it. But first, I'll tell you about Lucy. So Lucy is the daughter of one of our most avid urine donors. Some of our urine donors up in Vermont, I mean, they just love donating us their urine. And this is one of them. And Lucy is their daughter, who has enjoyed collecting her own urine in her little chair and donating it. And I want to end on this note because, you know, when you think about how social change works, you know, we're a room full of people that were brought up with a flush toilet for the most part, most of us. And so that's all we think about. That's all we can imagine when we think of what sanitation is. So where's the best way to start making changes that have to make, what we have to make for the future, given the environmental reality, given climate change realities and challenges before us? I think one of the best and most fun and cutest places to start is with children. Children get this idea. You explain it to them and they go, well, yeah, that makes sense. In a way that sometimes adults that are stuck in the flush toilet paradigm say, really, is that possible? Well, you can see what Lucy thinks about it. She's just having a blast. Dory had said that maybe you guys would want to hear about some of the experiences I've also had down in Mexico with people that are doing urine diversion and fertilization. So that's what is going on down here, right next to, I like to put it next to the image of what's happening in Vermont, because you really get to see that across very different spaces with different socioeconomic populations, this technology and this practice makes sense, you know, and people want to do it. So the question is how and for who. So, but if we want to, we'll move into questions and comments.
You need to connect with a Cape Cod contingent, I know that. I had an organic, not certified, I was for 9 years, but no longer. I grow medicinal plants, make the medicines, dispense them. I have 55-gallon drums that I buy my grain alcohol in. I have a greenhouse. And I have an espresso cafe as part of my herbal apothecary. Thousands of people come in there. And because my septic system wouldn't take it, I bought an old porta potty off of Craigslist. So it seems to me from your presentation that if I could collect the urine in that porta potty or another one from those thousands of people who come through, put it in those 55-gallon drums, put it in the greenhouse to sterilize. Now, how do we get the logistics of pickup and delivery and blah blah blah?
Yeah,
it's all new to all of us.
Yeah.
You
need to get the infrastructure going where we can have someone do a route of picking this, bringing it to a place.
That sounds like a fantastic idea, I just have to say. And what I have
so
to say,
I'd
too,
like
is...
I'd like to connect with the Cape Cod people on that. George and the Falmouth contingent.
Definitely. And let me say one thing, too, about the Vermont project, because that's really the project that I've been involved with since the beginning, that we didn't foresee a lot of what was going to happen. It's not like we had that five-year vision where we said, and then we're going to take on and see if we can work with the septic hauler, and then we're going to see if we can work with the wastewater treatment people. It's just something that came about as we were working in the community. And I think the most important thing is to just start doing it. And yes, do exactly what you're saying. Work with the people that also see things the way that you do and want to try to make things work as much as possible, and things start to come up, you know. But just start doing it.
Well, one important follow-up, or part of that, uh-huh. which I've been aware of for years as an herbalist, is the tremendous amount of pharmaceutical drugs that people take, especially on Cape Cod, mm-hmm. the population
yep.
is, you know, like me, older. Mm-hmm. But I don't take them yet. Mm-hmm. But, so how do we know how much of those PPCBs are mm-hmm. in that urine, and how do we get rid of that, and do we know yet how it affects the growth of plants? I was always taught that every time you take antibiotics, you pee it out, and antibiotics don't stop killing. They keep killing in
yeah.
the soil,
yeah.
which is a bad thing. So mm-hmm. that's something I would be wary of putting on any plants, really.
Yep.
So how do we get that information?
And I think a great point is that since people haven't been fully considering this technology yet, those questions haven't been asked as rigorously as they should be. But because people are starting to look at this technology and implement it, we can now start to actually study those questions, and that's exactly what the Rich Earth is doing this summer. I don't know, Kim, if you want to say something quickly about that.
I'd love to answer you. We just sent our first set of samples of urine off to the University of Michigan, mm-hmm. and it's so exciting because I'm not a scientist myself, but they're going to do DNA sequencing on all this urine. They're going to do a viral to totally check all the organics, and this is just, it's going to take about 2 years for us to get through this study. Mm-hmm. The first year, everybody's developing their methodology in the labs, and we're developing a lot in the fields. We're using some lysimeters that George is actually help us figure out how to create and testing the leachate, we're testing the soils, and the team that is working on this is really phenomenal. In our kickoff meeting, I was so excited afterwards, and I got up the next morning and I was thinking, you know, there's industry leaders here, there's academics, and somehow the rich earth we squeezed in too. And I think they were going to be asking this question anyway about what to do, what's going on with pharmaceuticals, but they actually added in the component of looking at source-separated urine into their study. They were going to be looking at wastewater treatment things and different options, but they included us, and we're a very integral part of the study now. So we're actually about to, we're doing all the field work, and they're sending samples to us, and we're sending to them, and we think that the soils will break down a lot of things, but we're looking at 16 specific persistent chemicals that are from pharmaceuticals that are already very prevalent in the environment, like caffeine and like you said, antibiotics, and we're looking at viruses as well. So it's very exciting, and there aren't going to be any initial results. But I want to explain that the EPA is funding this, and the National Water Environment Research Foundation, which is our national wastewater treatment industry research organization. They help wastewater treatment plants develop more and more complex systems. And they're the ones that have said, yes, let's go on this. They see it. The wastewater treatment industry sees that this needs to be figured out. Mm-hmm. Because they're starting to look at urine diversion. Yeah. As a possible solution. They know they're polluting like crazy. When we were in West Virginia, the Virginia Beach, we heard that it was going to cost $800 million just to elevate the treatment plants in that area to meet the new EPA standards. So it's a money issue.
Yeah.
We all don't have the money to build those plants.
The wrong direction.
Yes.
Well, there's also that extremely exciting work that Paul Stamets is doing with micro-remediation with mushrooms.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sludge. And I have a very good friend, Wes Price, who has teamed up with Todd and formed Nantucket Mushrooms down in Chatham, where they're growing mushrooms in big greenhouses for retail sales and wholesale sales. But that could perhaps be tied into, if we find out that there can be micro remediation of the toxins or the pharmaceuticals that might be in these. Now you've got a great system going there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to incur transportation costs by taking urine far away from local crops.
Mm-hmm.
So why was it at one point, I think I heard you say, I imagine it's evaporated and turned into a solid. What's the line of reasoning behind that?
You mean historically, as a historical practice?
No, I thought you said something about, is this really a biosolid? And you had to explain to people, no, it's not. But I thought you also said that it, at one point, at least some people are solidifying urine.
Right, they're trying to produce a solid soil amendment as opposed to a liquid one. Is that what you mean with the Florence?
Yeah.
Yep, they're taking urine. They're taking urine that's been source separated and they're adding it to carbonaceous materials to make a compost, because that for some people is easier to use and apply.
Okay, and then you put on an appropriate small amount of that instead of diluting it with water.
Yeah, and you guys want to say something?
There are at least three ways you could try to get a solid fertilizer from this urine. One of them is to just put it with wood chips and leaves and make normal compost. That would work. One is to make crystals out of it by adding magnesium oxide, which is a powder, and you stir it into the urine, and these crystals form within 10 minutes and fall out. And they have nitrogen in them and phosphorus in them, and you get this pure crystalline fertilizer, which is stable and saleable and is completely sterile. There are no pharmaceuticals in it. So that's one way. And the third way, which people can do on a small scale, and Ben actually first told us about this, and Ricky Baruch does it, you take liquid urine and you pour it into a bucket which has wood pellets, which is sawdust, basically, and diatomaceous earth, which is a crystal, like a natural mineral. And you put those three together and stir it up, and it becomes basically odorless because these diatomaceous earth crystals absorb the nitrogen and the odors, and it becomes a solid, looks like sawdust. And you can like use it in the garden, underneath plants and along the side dressings and under seedlings and under seedling trays, and you just treat it like a solid material.
That's what we're doing in our garden.
That's what we're doing. It looks great. Mm-hmm.
Also,
but to be sure about the pathogens, you should do some step to kill the pathogens first.
Yeah. The only pathogens you get is from cross-contamination by improper handling yourself, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the only reason you could have pathogens. So that's why this country is extremely careful. You have to sterilize it or this way, or you have to wait 6 months. But you can just have a bucket and just wait for 3 months, and then it's fine. You can use it that way. So if you always think ahead, you don't have to do any other step and just wait. And if you ever want to transport the liquid, that is hard to do from over county borders, I believe. But if you make it into a solid by mixing it into this, it's no longer a problem.
Well, it's no longer legally a problem.
Right.
So that's
still,
important.
But it's still considered septic. And you need to be licensed to haul it. And what I learned is it's from town to town, not county to county. So you have to get a permit. You want to take it from this town to the next town, you can get a permit for that. But if you want to take it to the third town, you got to get another permit.
Yeah.
So.
But it's nice to apply in a home scale or a small scale. It's really, and it's stable and it's odorless, so you can just mix it anytime and save it till you need it.
Right.
And then we put a little bit in every hole and.
Yeah, and that's the type of innovation that I really wanted to get at, where if you just start doing it, then when you start to have a bigger idea, you figure out, also because you have a base of practice and knowledge, and you know what works and what doesn't, and you've been talking to people about what you're doing, so now when Adele and I want to make this solid compost at our farm in Massachusetts, well, yeah, nobody's done that before. How exactly are we going to do that? But they've been collecting their urine. They've been able to, you know, have it to be able to do scientific samples on it. And we have a relationship with Rich Earth, which makes our case very strong. So when we go to regulators, say you want to start moving it to the next town over, if you have that built experience because you've just started doing it and learning as you go along, then you can tackle that as it comes along. But my recommendation is, if you're interested in starting this, don't think down to, well, shoot, well, when we want to take it across the town line, it's not going to work, so we should just, you know, just kind of do, if it's something you're interested in, do it and see where it gets you.
I just to clarify, I didn't mean that you shouldn't take it across town line.
Yeah, I know what you do, Ben. Yeah. I can't tell people what you do. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the optimum dilution rate for using an accordion?
Well, the dilution of your urine to begin with varies a lot. And do we appreciate that up in Vermont, because people bring us our urine and it's a whole rainbow of colors.
Right.
You've got almost, you know, clear urine to, you know, people walk away and we recommend that they start drinking more water because they've got, you know, very dense looking urine. So there's not the rate, but the rates that I'm familiar with range from 3 parts water to 1 part urine, all the way up to 10 parts water, 1 part urine. In the projects I've been engaged in, 1 to 2, 3 to 1, and 1 to 5 have been used the most. So I guess the first one that I would say is actually 1 to 2, not 1 to 3. What do you guys think?
It depends a lot on your soil. So if you have a sandy soil, you lose a lot quickly. You don't want to have that happen. So you do a very low concentration very often, so the plants take it up before it goes down. If it's a soil that's very high in clay, you have to be more careful because it won't stay there. So we do in the clay a kind of sandy loam that we have now on the Cape where we have our garden built up. I do about 1 to 10, but I do it regularly. So I think about in the vegetable garden, I do it, I try to do it every week, but if I forget, it's fine, I do it every 2 weeks. But I do, you know, a little bit in the watering can, I fill the rest with water. and all my flowers are just cute. So that's one. And then the other thing I wanted to comment is that Silent Spring is doing research on the pharmaceuticals, because they have been doing that on the groundwater in the Cape because of the high breast cancer rates on the Cape. And they're trying to connect it to our pollution in the groundwater. And they have now started to work with the EcoToilet program in Falmouth. So they select people that are willing to to tell what kind of pharmaceuticals they take, and they following it in the composting toilet to see, well, actually, they're doing it, not yet totally, but they're working on it. That's that's where they want to see it, because we think that a lot of pharmaceuticals will break down in the composting process, which is different than the urine diversion. And then the next stage is putting it in the ground, where another organisms, lots of organisms, will break down the rest. And then we don't know if there's anything still left to be taken up by plants, or if it's detrimental to the soil.
I think there's also research that needs to get done about what parts of the plants, if any, take up which parts of the contaminants.
At this point, it's more of a worry than a confirmation that plants do in fact take up these compounds. We don't actually know that they do to begin with. So that's why I say we clarify we're doing research on the fate of these pharmaceuticals up in Vermont, because we actually don't know what the fate is. It's not, well, we have to measure how much is in the plants. We don't even know that necessarily they are getting taken up by the plants. So let me, does anybody that hasn't asked a question yet have a question? Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just interested in the relationship between this, or potential relationship or benefit for cranberry bogs, and I'm not speaking of cranberry industry, not worried about the cranberry industry, but in this area there's a lot of small cranberry bogs, family bogs, people that work their bogs in the backyard, and there's also a few, there's one called, I think, called Coal Bogs in Carver, and there's a new one just down the road here near the water that the town owns and is running. They hope to fund environmental management practices through the sale of the cranberries from that. But I know one of the issues is fertilizing these cranberry bogs can be very expensive. And I was wondering if there are any like self-contained processes, you know, that farms use, or small agriculture operations, where that's there and the whole process happens there.
Since that's not really a permitted process, especially in the US, I've heard of farms that do that. And it's a secret. And it's not that they're producing food for public consumption and they're not telling people. They're producing it for their own consumption, but by nature of also having a farm as a separate entity, they can't do it. So I've not heard about above the board farms that are doing that yet in the US.
So you can, so a farm is fine to bring it in, but not fine to do it there and use it there.
Neither.
Yeah.
I don't think you're allowed to use it yet.
You're not. I think in the new farm bill that was just updated, they specifically added a line that said that human waste could not be applied to sellable farm products.
But what about all the sludge that's being
used? Yes. Yeah. There, that's the big exception.
So exactly. Just hay. That was what you were saying. It was just hay.
Yes.
For the farm animals. Fine for the farm animals.
So sludge, since it's this entrenched thing that we're familiar with, it has been approved over time. It goes often through a pasteurization process. For example, that's one of the reasons that we've had to pasteurize urine up in Vermont, even though when you know about the potential pathogens that could be in source-separated urine, pasteurization is like way excessive of what you would ever really need to do to remediate the urine. And yet pasteurization is often required for sludge to reach a class A classification to be applied as a fertilizer. So sludge is pasteurized, and that has been something that's been accepted. In the new farm bill, they're saying that basically what we're talking about here, if you have your own waste that you've processed, you can't put that as a soil amendment. And especially if you are actually making sellable products for market. So.
I could talk to you about what the regs are for composting toilet compost,
mm-hmm.
which is you can use it once it's removed from the composter.
Mm-hmm.
You can bury it on your property.
Right.
And you need to bury it for a secondary composting period of a year, mm-hmm. and then you can use it.
Mm-hmm.
So you can use it, but it has to go through that additional microbial soil relationship mm-hmm. before it can be used.
And also my understanding with composting toilets is that also if you have a composting toilet, either it's a pre-approved system, which the regulatory framework is familiar with, or if you have anything that varies from that, you have to get that individual toilet that you have set up permitted. So it's also, you're allowed to do these certain practices in different states, and they do vary by state, but that's also only if you have a certified, recognized composting toilet. We don't have a system where you can collect your waste and apply it however you want, you know, and be above the board and have it be technically legal.
We have time for two more questions.
Okay. I'd like to ask you, yeah.
This is just, I don't even know if you know the answer, if anyone in the audience does. What does anyone here know about mixing urine with wood ash and applying that to your home garden?
So, I know just some very introductory stuff, which is that the ash and biochar is something that people are starting to do a lot of research with, particularly because it eliminates odors very quickly. And that's something that we're also working with this summer, is creating a compost, I believe, that has biochar and ash in it. So I don't know if you know more details about that.
I do know that I have somebody that's informally doing an ash and urine study, but I also asked Abe about it, and he said that you can use the ash and the urine, but not to put them on at the same time.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So it's mm-hmm. a mix the ash with the soil, and then later come around and put some urine on
Did
it.
Did he have a reason why not at the same time?
Yes, but it was very chemical, and I didn't.
Right.
I think it temporarily takes the nutrients yeah. away from where it's not available to plants for a while.
Okay.
How I understand it, but I can't.
Oh. That sounds like a great question. Are you currently a student? Do you want to study that? And
do you need students? Because I know some people that could talk to you about what we're discovering.
Yeah, actually, that would be great.
Can I mention something about the dilution rates?
Yeah, go ahead.
Because we were funded last year to study the dilution rates on hay with the urine, and we're replicating the study again this summer, but one of the things that we were really hopeful about was that we could dilute it as little as possible, because this turned out to be a real barrier for adoption at the farm, because just bringing the urine out to the field was heavy enough, but for them to have to bring three times as much water is really prohibitive in their practice. And we were really thrilled because we did apply pure urine with no dilution, and it did not burn the hay.
Really?
We were thrilled because that was possible. And so we'll be repeating that on three different strips, longer strips, bigger place, different soil type this summer. But that was really a good thing to learn. So,
but it did initially burn the soil, right?
In the first year that you and I worked into the smaller plots, we added a double strength of the urine, and we did burn some of the hay, which did then come back more strongly. Mm-hmm. But this last year, when we put pure urine on strips, and when we did 100% and then another 150% and a 200% of the amount of urine that we put on, it did not burn at all. So
wow.
That was really good.
Can I just make a quick comment?
Mm-hmm.
I know there's no more time left. But so something I struggle with in my head is, so I'm not flushing the toilet, but then I'm creating, and I don't water my gardens, well, just let Mother Nature rain and stuff like that. But so here I am now diluting. So where am I winning? And maybe someone can explain it to me, because maybe I'm just not getting it. But so I'm not flushing, but then I'm diluting. So isn't it water one way or the other?
The water's going out of plants, though, not down the dam.
True. Okay, so I knew someone would help me out.
Flushing is a whole lot more.
It's 100 times.
Well, I put things in my tank to make it a little bit of water. And we, if it's yellow, let it mellow. Okay. But we're saving the pee too. But then, so direct apply, going back to what you were saying, direct apply would make me feel better, I think, too, than diluting so
there's
much.
There's another one that wasn't mentioned, that we don't know by doing it 100% pure, how much actually is taken up by the plant,
right,
and how much goes
right
into the ground.
Right, because then if it rains, it's getting
right
diluted.
And that's the whole,
right,
we're in the Cape, and many places here,
sandy,
we cannot
mm-hmm
have it go into the groundwater, otherwise they'll say no more of this.
Mm-hmm.
We have to make sure that plants take it all up, it stays
right
above that.
Right.
And so that's why
so
you're
if you
making
go,
that mixture with the peat.
That's
right
good, because it holds it for much longer.
Right.
It
mm-hmm
so it becomes available to the plant over a long period of time.
Mm-hmm.
And if you put it on 100%, the plant can only
yep
pick up so much in a certain
mm-hmm
time, and if it goes below the root zone, it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's where we don't want it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a really hard balance and hard to
yep
study.
That's true.
Yeah.
So that's why I do it, very, and I don't use a lot of water. I mean, this much, it's just fill up a can, water
mm-hmm
can, and it takes half my garden filled. So I'm not pouring lots of it on each plant. It's totally
right
unscientific.
Right.
No. Let's just be clear.
Once a week, I put some in my pot, there's flowers, and it just goes.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm
you're not selling little kits yet that we can buy and take?
It's like whatever, that's your green thumb, but it becomes a yellow thumb.
Very good. Okay.
Well. Yes, wonderful. Thank you. What a wonderful, informative talk.